Courtyard by Marriott presents CNBC-TV18 Disruptors.
Just a little over 16 years ago, an Indian woman, Meera Kulkarni, was perturbed as to why there were no premium quality Ayurvedic handmade soaps in the market. She turned this personal interest of making soaps at home into a little business, and thus was born India's market leader in luxury Ayurveda, Forest Essentials. A brand that projects nature and purity as its core focus, Meera initially began with a line of pure oils and handmade soaps, and today, Forest Essentials boasts of over 140 products ranging from 24-karat gold-infused facial creams to sheet masks, from Ayurvedic shampoos to de-stress oils, and even a range of skincare just for men. On this episode of The Disruptors, we throw the spotlight on Forest Essentials and discover the journey behind the brand's success. I'm in conversation with Mr. Samrat Bedi, the Executive Director here at Forest Essentials. Thanks so much for joining us on CNBC-TV18's Disruptors. And let me begin by asking you, what exactly led to the birth of this baby, so to speak? It was started by your mother in 2001, right?
Yes. I think the idea behind it was she was trying to find a high-quality product which represented India, represented our traditions, and I think when she went to the market, all she found were masstige brands with questionable ingredients. And in that process, actually, where we've had a long history with Rishikesh, sure. And so she went back there, and we actually went to find out if it was possible to make a product which was natural, which was high quality, and would actually have deliver on its promise. So this is something that she set out to do, and I think that's really where the whole idea started from.
And if I can ask you, India has been synonymous with Ayurveda for years and centuries now, but what really made it seem like there was a market out there for luxury Ayurveda? Because you've created a market segment in a space that it didn't exist in before.
You know, luxury Ayurveda today is a very used term. So there are many, many brands now who say we are luxury Ayurveda. But I think what they miss out is actually why we started to look at that concept. The idea was, we already know that Ayurveda is fabulous, it's very effective, it's something that has proven science behind it, it's 5,000 years old. I think what we also found was that Ayurveda, while it was being so effective, was also a very tough and age-old process. It was something that hadn't changed or developed in terms of the way it was being used, the way it was represented over many, many years. We took this idea, and when we call it luxury Ayurveda, the idea is to say it's luxurious for Ayurveda. So it's all relative to Ayurveda. Right, so the idea behind it is to say that we can take this efficacy, we can take these age-old traditions, and we can actually make it more modern. So when we started to actually see about how to do this, a lot of things came into perspective, because Ayurveda is a lifestyle, it's not just a product. And since it encompasses everything that you do, we had to actually sit down and review the entire process. And I think the idea was to actually maintain that efficacy, but make it something available to a consumer today.
And going back, when did your association with Forest Essentials actually begin?
So I actually, my mother started tinkering around in late 2000. And that's when I was in New York doing corporate banking. And I had decided to come back to India. And when I did come back to India in 2001, I saw what she was doing. And I asked her if I could help. So I helped set up the first computer and the account system and stuff like that. And within 6 months of actually working with her, I requested if we could just start looking at this as a full-time association. And she agreed.
Sure.
And we've been working since then.
So it was an accidental entrepreneurship almost?
Truly, yeah. I mean, I was actually going to go back and look at another job. And when I saw this, then I thought from day one, I've always enjoyed it. There was never any market research. There was never any consumer studies. It was purely a gut instinct, and it was a passion. And I think to where it's grown today is the antithesis of any MBA study. So it was none of the usual regular ways of going about it. And I think what's driven it very strongly is that passion, and I think that absolute need to have the passion and the hard work to put behind it, I think has worked out very well.
And if you go back and look at when did the first ever store come about at Forest Essentials? And even before that, what were the first kind of products that you launched under the brand?
Launch would be an overstatement. It was basically, it was products that, it was handmade soaps. That's really what triggered off the entire process. And it was in these handmade soaps that, you know, when we started looking at the ingredients, which was, you know, almond oil or jojoba or, you know, even ghee and essential oil. And when we actually made the soap and the costing didn't sit down because we were like, how are the other soaps being sold for 10, 12, 15, 20, 30 rupees when just the cost of our ingredients is three times that. And when we did a little more research, we figured out that there's obviously, you know, different ways of making soaps.
Absolutely.
And even when we actually launched the product, and I remember in 2001, it was priced at about 90 to 100 rupees, you know, compared to the average of 15 to 20.
Mm.
And everybody was like, you're crazy. There's nobody who's going to buy it. And there was a market. There were actually people looking for better quality. There were people looking for a story. They were looking for pure ingredients. And that's when we started this whole segment, because the entire pricing that you see today that exists in what you'd like to call luxury Ayurveda or, or this space, the prestige space, has been driven by us since 2001.
Mm-hmm.
So it's actually evolved from there onwards. And in terms of products, we had handmade oils, which again, pure, you know, oils that we were pulling out, because again, when we started looking to the industry, whether it's food or whether it's skincare, there was a lot of adulteration going on. And it was nice to actually have something that you've pulled out and which is absolutely pure. And the market started from there.
So you were ahead of the curve in a certain sense, because now it's all about the pure, you know, organic market out there. And clearly 2001 itself, you started thinking of this. When did that first store, brick and mortar of sorts, come about for Forest Essentials? Where even?
So even in terms of when I say the market, right, at that point, of course, it was a lot of gut instinct, but I mean in terms of products, in terms of pricing, in terms of even distribution. So we also realized that these are things that are going to be inherent to our brand.
Absolutely.
So when you said ahead of the curve, all of this always existed in our philosophy, despite not knowing where the curve was leading, right? So we said it's always going to be a high quality, it's always going to be pure ingredients. And we also realized that we wanted to sell it in a in an ambiance which didn't exist in retail those days. So either small boutiques, or there were stores in hotels, or there was the bigger department stores. And for us, we didn't feel that the product actually fitted into any one of these places. So when we got the opportunity in 2004, we actually took a store in Khan Market. I mean, you can imagine how much trepidation it was because
Absolutely.
Of the rent
most
and everything.
Expensive retail space in India, right?
So then we decided we're going to do it, that we need to do it correctly. And we actually then took that risk. We had to sign a bond. We went through the whole thing. But you know, it's been no looking back. That store still exists today. It's one of our highest performers, and it's where we then also said that we will only do it out of our own stores, and that's what we do till today.
Fantastic. What has the product range really grown to and mushroomed since you just began with, say, you know, soaps and luxury oils and the sort?
You know, today the product range has expanded. Again, we're careful not to make products for the sake of making products. So every single product should have a story. It should have a philosophy and it should have a use. So what we've done is our strength lies in our facial care. And that's the something that we've been growing. And you know, when you do look at a lot of brands today, even in our segment, it's a lot about body. So, you know, oils and shampoos and shower gel, stuff that are easy to do. It's not so hard. But facial care is something, and especially for getting a consumer to trust you to put them on their face is the big deal. And we find that that market is something that we do very, very well.
So Samrat, what's the kind of product range in terms of a ballpark figure that you are at currently?
So today we have about 150 products. This goes across four verticals. So we have skincare, which is facial. We have hair care, we have body care, and something we call wellness, which has all our essential oils and burners and stuff like that.
And what's the kind of distribution in terms of where are you at? Is it just, you know, brick and mortar boutiques? Are you online as well? Are you seeing traction in the online space?
So online, as we all know, has been growing rapidly, I think, for everybody. So it's a big story now. Mm-hmm. We actually started our online business in 2010. Mm. And that was actually to cater to the consumers who were buying the products here and you know, had no access to our stores. So if they were coming from other countries or there was other towns, they couldn't buy it. And that was the idea. It was more of a customer service module. And then, of course, online started to grow, and then you had everyone come in from the Amazons to the Flipkarts, and this changed the landscape. Mm-hmm. Since then, we have, you know, put a lot of time and focus into this vertical, and today it's 10% of our business. So it continues to grow at over 120% a year.
Fantastic.
And I think we'll continue to drive the future. A lot of people, you know, either use online or use offline. We think at some point it will converge. Not in the near future, but it will. So I think what we have as a combination of brick and mortar and online is a compelling one.
One of the things that you're very careful about is the purest, most organic ingredients. Where does the manufacturing of forest essentials for our viewers, where does that take place?
So again, and you know, I come back to a segment very often because, you know, today we are what we like to call farm to bottle. So we literally source our own ingredients, we manufacture it, we then bring it to our stores and we sell it to the consumer. So it's an entire chain that we've set up, which is quite unique amongst a lot of brands. So in the what we call luxury Ayurveda now, there are no brands who have an end-to-end solution. So some of them actually have contract manufacturing, some of them may be selling out of different department stores. So from there, that makes us quite unique, because Ayurveda, some of the products are very common, you know, a bringraj oil or some like, and you can source it from a number of places. What sets us apart is that we make our own stuff. So we actually source our own ingredients, we have our own formulations, and that allows us to keep a certain product quality. Today we have two facilities. One was the original workshop we set up in 2004. It's in a very remote location in the Himalayas, and it still stands there, and it's a testimony to our philosophy and brand. We do a lot of our you know, our women empowerment, a lot of our local CSR policies, everything comes from there. And we have a bigger plant which we set up in Haridwar, where the actual final packaging and finishing takes place. So it basically have two plants together.
When did you think there was a market for men's personal care products? When did that integrate into Forest Essentials?
You know, globally, men's products, and as we've been told by our partners, by many, you know, many people, that men's product never made money. It was a product extension. But then, you know, we strongly believed in India, it's very different. You can't have a global look to every country. You must have to understand its own, you know, idiosyncrasies. And I think in India, we found, and we've seen this over the last 6-8 years, how men are taking care of themselves, how much grooming is going on. If you look at it in your own beauty parlors and, you know, in various places, it's a record number of men actually looking after themselves now. And I think, and we've seen some success with some, you know, shaving products and other brands.
Absolutely.
And we've seen, but we've had a range, but we, in the last 2 years, actually extended that range because we think there's a lot of potential to grow. And, you know, from basically 2% of our business, it's doubled. And I think there's a lot more to happen because men are much more conscious now and are starting to ask a lot about their skin, wanting to take care of themselves, and it's fantastic to see growing.
What is the kind of market size that luxury Ayurveda in India currently occupies, or even a global figure for that?
You know, it's probably one of the toughest questions you're going to ask me today, because the problem is that, you know, we've read a number of reports, and even in India ourselves, because the market is so unorganized, right? It's all figures that come out. In terms of guesses, best guess situations.
There's so not estimate, guesstimate in that sense.
So guesstimate, I would put the market of what we calculated between 1,200 and 1,500 crores. So it's still very, very small.
Sure.
But the growth is 3 times, you know, the other segments of skincare. So I think that people are strongly leaning towards understanding, you know, especially the trends from natural to organic, and even Ayurveda today. So we're seeing a lot of traction here, and this will grow much faster, but still a small market.
out what is the kind of market share that Forest Essentials enjoys currently?
So currently we are the market leaders. Again, you know, it's still guesstimates of what we do. Yeah. But I think we have, you know, more than 25-30% of the market. So that's where we stand.
And if I can ask you to put on your looking glass of sorts, and is there a target 2022, target 2025 for where you want the brand as such to reach?
So, you know, we've talked about 23 because you can make business plans for 10 years, you know, very little actually pans out.
Yeah.
But by 23, we think we've got the potential to be at 120, 150 stores in this country. Mm-hmm. And we're also looking at international expansion. So there's going to be a combination of this. Of course, I'd like online to grow. Mm-hmm. So online is going to be a very, very strong focus for us.
What are your top sellers, you know, of sorts at the Forest Essential brand?
So for us, you know, because we also keep looking at the product range very, very closely, I'd hate to tell you that everything sells well, but but in terms of you were to actually look at the market things, I think for us, the Sondarya cream, you know, our facial skincare again, so Sondarya cream, Sondarya serum, we have a date and lychee youth formula. So these are the products that do very, very well. It's got a great fan following, and it's actually something that always heads our list.
Sellers, then talk to us about some of the more exotic ingredients that you use in your product line, and where do you source them from?
So sourcing ingredients from India has been a bit of a challenge, and because we have such a large country, what we've actually done is to actually pick up local ingredients from places they're famous for.
Sure.
And I mean, when I talk about ingredients itself, you know, we talk about saffron from Kashmir, we talk about jasmine from the south, from Madurai, we talk about rose from Kannauj. We talk about lemongrass from Ooty. So there's a lot of products that are coming out from where they're actually grown and they're organic and they're very, very effective. And the idea behind that is to actually then put it together and give a consumer a product that works.
The Vedas are a large body of religious texts that originated in ancient India. These Sanskrit scriptures were broadly divided into four main Vedas: the Rig Veda, Sama Veda, Yajurveda and Atharva Veda. Ayurveda is a subsection of the Atharva Veda and is believed to be the oldest and most holistic health mapping system for human beings. It focuses on healing, protection and longevity of human life. Samrat, we were chatting about the product line really, but now talk to us about the kind of retail presence that you have. You know, is it just flagship boutiques that you still continue to do, or are you in some multi-brand stores as well? What's the kind of retail presence? And
We actually do continue to drive our brick and mortar expansion through our own stores. We also have worked with Sephora and now with Nykaa in the offline stores. So these are the only other two partnerships that we have outside, because this is something that I think is a good fit for our brand. Other than that, again, we just continue to do our own stores.
Difficult was it cracking that Sephora deal? Because if I'm not mistaken, you're the only Indian brand in Sephora, right?
Yes, there were originally two Indian brands there, and today there is only us, because I think the market reacted to us well in Sephora, and that's something that we continue to drive. And I think it's actually a great sign because it gives us a bit of international and global credibility that an Indian brand can sit there and compete with all the hundreds of brands that they have.
Absolutely. If I can ask you the kind of number of stores you're present in and number of cities really here in India?
You know, there's always a number of stores being, it's under fit out, but I think today we'd be at about 70 stores across about 23 cities.
So if you go to a major airport in this country, you do see a Forest Essentials store there. So talk to us really about travel retail as a space for Forest Essentials.
So this is a segment that I actually, you know, I put a lot of focus on nearly 3 years ago. So we understood that eventually a lot of demand is going to come out of the airports, what we call TR, travel retail.
Uh-huh.
And we took the first steps to actually having our stores in most of the major airports. We are continuing to keep an eye on it because there is a lot of expansion going on in regional airports as well. And I think in the next 5-8 years, there's going to be a lot more airports that will open up to allow us to actually retail out of there. Very disciplined about taking the brand international. And the idea was to actually make sure that we were market leaders, that whatever we had to learn, all our evolutions, everything was done here in the country. We have been looking at international expansion now. I think we're ready to actually take the brand outside.
Uh-huh.
The idea also is to make sure we don't take it out and put it into supermarkets or small little stores that a lot of these brands end up doing.
That will dilute your equity.
Are a couple of brands in luxury Ayurveda who are already doing that.
Yeah.
But that's something that we want to go and open our own stores. We want to be strong enough to be treated as a prestige brand globally amongst everybody else as well. And that's what we're working on now. And I think that'll take us another 15 to 18 months uh-huh. with regulatory, with product and with packaging. And I think we should be opening, like I said, in the next 2 years.
And Samrat, what are some of the geographies that you could be interested in? What are some of the global destinations that you think you could see a lot of traction in consumers?
We've used a sense of logic and we've used obviously some consumer service to understand. And I think the idea is to keep it close to home.
Sure.
The idea is to also see, similar diasporas, similar citizens who would actually have an affinity to the smell or understand Ayurveda. And so there are various options on the table, from Asia to the Middle East, we're even looking at Singapore. Possibly the UK. Mm-hmm. UK is a very expensive market,
yeah.
So possibly in phase two. But as far as we see it, we've looked at many countries and we find there's a demand in a lot of them already.
Luxury comes with a price tag, right? Is that a conscious decision that you've maintained through the years? And the pricing strategy, simply because you source the best, you realize that the price has to be at that level? Does the consumer accept that argument?
It is a combination of this. I think, what we've also realized is that when you make a product of this quality, it's not just sourcing the ingredients, it's also how you make it, where you make it, the processes that you follow, the kind of packaging that you use. So you can't really attribute it to one factor, but when you actually look at the entire process and what goes into it, I think for that, and especially, being a very socially conscious company in terms of our processes even cost more because we use solar power, we use, rain harvesting, we pay our staff better. We want to make sure that, we have global standards. And
absolutely,
that does cost money. But the idea is that I think a consumer, when they see what we're bringing to the table, the price is irrelevant. Because at the end of the day,
mm-hmm.
if the product is giving you and touching all the points that you want, then I think the pricing becomes a secondary part of things.
Sure. Samrat, another interesting thing is this is not just for personal consumption. Because today, more and more as you think of it, the minute you want to gift somebody something, when it's a festive season or a celebratory occasion, you want to reach out for that, hamper at Forest Essentials. So is that again a conscious consumer targeting strategy that you have?
I think what's nice about the brand is it's very versatile.
Uh-huh.
So you can use it for anything you like. A lot of brands sometimes only stand for gifting, or some brands only stand for the fact that you use their products personally.
Yeah.
Here is a combination where you can actually use the products and it's part of your everyday routine, but you can also gift it.
Absolutely.
And at certain price points, it takes the place of many, many other gifts and is a much more nice and personalized gift to give. It shows that you've given a lot more thought into gifting someone and it's it's working across various categories very well for us.
Looking back, some of the key challenges that you've faced in creating a brand leader of sorts, and would you stay committed to the entrepreneurial journey? Because most of our viewers, a lot of them young aspiring entrepreneurs, would like to learn really from the challenges of businesses like yourself.
So India brings its own set of challenges, in terms of the sheer size of the country, the amount of cultures, the kind of how it differs from the south to the north to the east to the west. So everywhere we go, we're learning. You always have to understand that you're always going to learn. Nobody's perfected it yet. And every time we go into a new city, we see different nuances, even in the same state. And it's so interesting to see how India is actually such a vast region with so much in it. And even being Indians ourselves, we're still continuing to learn. So there have been a lot of challenges. There's logistics, there's infrastructure. But you have to be focused and you have to work hard. There is no shortcut to this formula. And that's something that you'll always have to understand, being an entrepreneur.
Fantastic. Mr. Samrat Bedi, an absolute pleasure chatting with you on CNBC-TV18's Disruptors.
Thank you very
much. And on that note, we're absolutely wrapped up on this edition. Remember to catch the entire interview on our social media platforms across Facebook, Twitter, and of course, on our website, cnbctv18.com. From the entire team that put the show together, goodbye, thanks for watching, and tune in next week for a brand new Disruptor.
Courtyard by Marriott presents CNBC-TV18 Disruptors.